So now I'm ready to return to a topic that I started a few lectures ago when we were looking at kinship and altruism. And I wanted you to recognize that humans are really different from other animals. We cooperate on a much, much more elaborate and grand scale than any other species, and it's not just within our families. So what is the basis? What's the foundation of human ethics? Darwin famously discussed this topic in his book, The Descent of Man, in 1871. In his general discussion of altruism and self-sacrificial behavior, he focused on humans. And he said this, he said, "He who is ready to sacrifice his life rather than betray his comrades would often leave no offspring to inherit his noble nature." That's the contradiction we've seen before with altruism. If you're really nice and you help somebody else out and you die, then your genes are lost, and only the recipient of your altruism survives, but the altruist himself may not leave any surviving offspring. But Darwin went to the next step with humans. He argued that this kind of altruistic behavior could in fact be beneficial in humans who are at war. And so he said, "A tribe including many members who are always ready to give aid to each other and sacrifice themselves for the common good would be victorious over most other tribes, and this would be natural selection." Evolutionary psychology, as I mentioned earlier, have looked at a number of complex issues, and they have thought hard about why it is that humans, unlike any other species, show this very special form of cooperation that extends out to a large number of people to whom we're not closely related. And they argue that religious identity is one of the most effective mechanisms for promoting within-group cooperation. Let's go back to this simple diagram that I've shown before. Here we have our selfish devil dogs, right? Now they're fighting each other. They can't get along with each other. And here are all of our angels, right? Now ordinarily this would be a problem that the devil dogs might infiltrate a nice group and their selfish behavior then spread. But now we have intergroup competition. Because they've been squabbling and fighting amongst themselves, their group is smaller. And our angels may only be angels with their own companions, but when they see strangers, if they attack en masse like lions and chimpanzees do and they kill the neighbors, then this is a powerful force for group selection. So group selection can work when larger groups cooperate to kill smaller groups. This is when we start wanting to worry about war. This is another human universal. War has punctuated our history at all phases. Our own country still lives with great scars from our civil war in the 1860s. Europe was devastated by the First World War and later by the Second World War. Asia, wars of liberation, the Vietnam War, numerous wars around the world that we've been involved with, most recently Iraq, Afghanistan. This is something that's been going on forever. Tribal groups have been fighting wars. It's something that's never stopped in the history of humans. The feelings that one has when we've been attacked by strangers, I don't know how many of you are old enough now to have a sense of what it was like after 9/11, when Americans were attacked by Osama bin Laden's people with the plane crashes in the World Trade Center and the Pentagon. But throughout this country, a country that was very sleepy, there was an upsurge of people saying, "We want to do something. We want to do something. We want to get involved because we've been attacked. We want to go and fight the enemy." And this sense of patriotism is seen over and over again. At the advent of all these terrible wars, there's always a number of people who say, "Yes, I want to go fight. I want to be part of this." It's also very, very widespread that once we've identified an enemy, we no longer view them as human. There are all kinds of derogatory terms that were used against enemies in Iraq, in the Western Afghanistan, in places wherever Americans have gone to war, in Vietnam. During World War I, the Germans were viewed as nothing more than brutes. This is, again, something that is a universal. We always minimize the fact that the enemy is no longer really one of us. It's very different. And also, it's not just that we have an inspiration ourselves to go out and fight, but our systems in our societies really put pressure on men to go out and be involved. involved with the fight. So here's a poster from World War I saying, "Your chums are fighting. Why aren't you?" You don't want to be seen as, in those days, a slacker was a terrible term for somebody who was like avoiding their responsibility in going to war. And here's something with, again, consequences on perhaps reproduction. If women say no to men who don't go, okay, there's another incentive for men to go out and prove themselves, that they are real men, that they're going to go out and they're going to fight. So our moral codes also shame men who don't put their lives on the line. And shaming itself seems to be such an innate behavior. It's something we all do. We get very angry if we see somebody not pulling their weight when it comes to fighting the enemy. So, human cooperativeness is likely to reflect a long history of these kinds of battles against other groups. We have, unlike any other species, an exceptional ability to remember what everyone has done. We have a very good memory of who the good guys are, who the bad guys are. We know who you are, and we saw what you did. We have language. Language helps us to codify and recall behaviors and times when we behaved well or poorly. We have well-defined group membership. At the beginning, back in the day when we were all hunter-gatherers, we lived in egalitarian groups. All of our resources were shared. We had a direct stake in the other members of our band in fighting together against a common enemy. Cooperation within the same group is extraordinary. It always has been, but we have hostility to neighboring groups. This is just the thing we've seen also in chimpanzees and in lions. Now, within a vast society, once you get so big you can't easily recognize every member of the band that you are now working with, there are other mechanisms that allow you to restrict membership of your in-group, and religion seems to serve that purpose. So that within a vast society, religious institutes restrict membership to a subset of well-behaved individuals and monitor each other's behavior. You can't go to the church unless you've been a good citizen, and they're all checking to see whether you've been behaving yourself. If that is true, then you can be part of the group and you can have all the benefits of group membership. Now, religion has a very strong effect on how stable our groupings are. And this is an interesting, almost experimental study that comes from the 19th century, where a lot of Americans wanted to form communes. They wanted to form isolated, separate societies that would function outside the state. And it's quite striking that the communes that were based on just some sort of hypothetical belief about the good of mankind, or we like the idea of making silverware together or whatever, those didn't last very long. So here's a survival curve. And so we have all the societies that were formed, and after a short time, almost 80% of those societies, within 10 years, they had disbanded. But if a commune was based on religion, so it's like the Quakers or the Mormons or anything else, those religious communes persisted far longer. And some of them lasted even over a century. So religion does provide a form of glue that allows these groups to maintain a much tighter community than otherwise. Now, in the history of our species, we went from being hunter-gatherers, these small groups of only 30 to 50 people, to much, much larger tribes. These may involve thousands of individuals. And this map of North America shows the location of numerous different Native American tribes. These are all hunter-gatherers up until the 19th century or so. And they had a strong sense of identity across broad geographical areas. And they were kept together. They had a common identity because of their religious and their cultural beliefs. As long as they recognized in each other these common beliefs, they were eager to work together. So these religious ideas helped to unite large numbers of people. And tribes could quickly mobilize. If there was going to be a war against one major grouping versus another, they could quickly recruit allies in this larger battle. And so this led to a necessity of everybody has to tribalize. If you don't have partners, you've got to get some quick. So there would have been pressure for these groupings to get larger and larger once it had originated within the human species. But then there was a profound change in our livelihoods. Agriculture made things a lot better in terms of finding food, and our populations could grow dramatically because there's a stable food supply in one place. But there was a downside to agriculture. Land now became very valuable. And those families, those individuals who happened to have the best land could hold on to them, exclude the rest of their group, and make sure that that land went to their own offspring. So inherited wealth became a huge problem, in a sense, for society with the advent of agriculture. And it's with the advent of agriculture we start seeing incredibly despotic societies where the very wealthy, the very lucky who had the best land and had the best resources could now subjugate their own companions, dating back as far as the pharaohs, to Europe in the 1700s, to China, even up into the early 20th century. So these two conflicting impulses, one towards working together for the common good, our group does battle against neighbors, it's us against them, as opposed to, well, you know, my group's doing pretty well, but I'm going to make sure that my family gets a little bit more of the goodies, leads to this kind of unfairness within society. And so our original social system was indeed egalitarian. Studies from all over the world show that hunter-gatherer bands really are egalitarian. There's not even a chief in many of these different groups. They all work together for the common good. And we still see, even in children, as I showed earlier, small children get very upset if they see an experiment where the outcome looks unfair. It's deep within us to want fair outcomes in the distribution of our fundamental resources. And we feel this in public outrisings, in societies that have gotten too elitist, too skewed in who gets the goodies and who doesn't. We always see a current coming from below to demand fairness. We saw that in China in Tiananmen Square in 1989, in Egypt in Tahrir Square in 2011, even in our own country. The 99% against the 1%, Occupy Wall Street. This is something that's a dynamic tension that will likely always go back and forth between wanting more fairness versus those individuals who have the reins of power who want to hold on to them. So human ethics is a very complex outcome originating from the need to protect ourselves, our group against neighboring groups. But then as our groups have gotten bigger and we have a more opportunity to monopolize for our own families, even against the best interests of our group, that we have to struggle to maintain a proper sense of fairness.